Thank you, everyone. And as we have come once again, that this is the third message of our series, as we are learning and tracking the life of David. And many of us in Sunday school can remember the day when we in Sunday school, we for the very first time hear the story of David and Goliath. And some of us, as we come today, and maybe this is your first time here, we do welcome you in the name of Jesus Christ. This place is for everyone who claim the name of Jesus. This place is for everyone who come here to learn more about God. Some of you are here, maybe at the beginning of the year, that you have made some resolutions. That is fine, because there is something inside of you that was stirring, wanting to shape the trajectory of your life. And so that's good. You made some resolution in a positive way for this coming year. But whether you did or not, I do pray that we will be more effective in our walk and in our love for our Lord Jesus Christ for 2017. And I do believe very seriously, even in my own life, that God has enough resources in his economy to do just that. This year could be the year of God's people, that God is going to do the greatest thing he has ever done in your life. Do you believe that? He's got his economy that you can draw from in every way and whatever experiences of life that you're going through. He has something for you in every part. And you may be in the most trying place in your life, the most challenging place in your life right now. You're facing some giants in your life. I want you to hear the promise of the Word of God, that I have taken it personally for 2017. That means a lot to me. It's the Word of God to Joshua when he said, "Have I not commanded you? Be strong and courageous. Do not be afraid. Do not be discouraged. For the Lord your God will be with you." I have taken that personally for 2017 in our life, my wife and I. So, in a way, whatever it is out there, bring it on. Because I know this for a fact, that the story that we're about to talk about is the story of a shepherd boy who faced a huge giant and defeated them. He defeated him from not a human perspective. But when you look at the way that the story, and we're going to look at that in a minute, you look at that story, he said, that is not how the story ought to end. Because from a human perspective, it's impossible. You got a shepherd boy with a giant, and God allowed David and used David to defeat this. How many of you love underdog stories? You know, we all cheer about the underdog stories. The little guy beating up on the big guy. We love those stories. We love that kind of, I like watching the Canadian Football League, you know, like, those of you who follow football, you remember the Grey Cup of 2016? Yeah, some of you? Only the brown-skinned people don't know what I'm talking about. Well, here that went. The Ottawa Red Blacks and the Calgary Stampeders went at it for the Grey Cup. Ottawa was the huge underdog, finishing in the Eastern Division with a record of 8 wins, 9 losses, and 1 tie. Their opponent, Calgary, on the other side, was the overwhelming favorite. In fact, they topped the whole CFL league with 15 wins, 2 losses, and 1 tie. But at the end of that game, the underdog won. Yay for Ottawa. 39-33 in overtime. We love those underdog stories. The kind of story When an underdog beats the overwhelming favorite, and it's not supposed to happen, right? Let me ask you a question. Have you ever felt outnumbered? Have you ever felt outpowered? Have you ever felt that you've been outsmarted, thinking that there is no way you can defeat the enemy that you're facing? Fact, it's just downright impossible. The good news is that it is possible to beat any giant that you're facing. It can be a reality in your story. And I want to talk about that, and I want you to turn to 1 Samuel chapter 17, and that's where we're going to come in. But I'm going to come in verse 4 because it's a long story. The text is long, and I'm just going to pick some verses, but I want to come in verse 4. But let me just build a context to you. In verses 1 to 3 of 1 Samuel chapter 17, you've got here confronted the army of Israel is their arch enemy, the Philistines. You have on one side of the hill, because this is happening right across up on the north part of the Mediterranean Sea in Israel today, a little bit of the north, we find that the Philistine people, where these are the coastal dwellers, they dwell all around the coastal plains. And the people of God was up in the hill country of the north. And for years, the Philistines have occupied the promised land, which is Canaan. And it was at this time where this mortal enemy of Israel was being confronted. And this hostility did not just happen at that time. This has happened for years and years and years. In fact, since the days of Joshua and the Judges, the Hebrews and the Philistines have battled regularly on and off. And here they gathered in a place called Elah, in the valley of Elah, and the battle was about to begin. And this battle that I need to tell you, that this battle was not just a physical contest to see who is the most powerful person. We need to understand that this was a deeply spiritual contest as well. It was not only a physical contest, it was a spiritual contest. It was a test to see who had the most powerful God. And so they are about to do battle this time, and the Philistines were convinced, because at that time that they were the superpowers of the day. They had bronze, they have iron. And their ultimate goal was to get God's people to question their God, give up trusting him, give up following him. That was their ultimate goal. And so this is not only a physical contest, because there is nothing more significant for the enemy of God's people than to see them be robbed of their joy in the Lord and be enslaved in fear. We are going to learn from this life of this man, how do we deal with our own Goliath, with our own challenges, with our own fear, when we are being confronted. But as we stand in 2017, can I tell you something that I already know about you in 2017? You are going to have some real problems and challenges. And I am going to too. I'm not picking on you, Mosaic, but that's just the way it is. Face it and bank on it. Challenges are not an exception in life, and that's why people get so surprised, because it becomes an exception, because okay, this is not an exception, it's part of your life. And in 1 Samuel chapter 17, let me just jump right into in verse 4, where they were ready to battle. They were in the valley of Elah and ready to battle. Verse 4 jumped in, a champion named Goliath, who was from Gath, came out of the Philistine camp. His height was 6 cubits in the span. He had a bronze helmet on his head and wore a coat of scale armor of bronze, weighing 5,000 shekels. On his legs, he wore bronze greaves, and a bronze javelin was slung on his back. His spear shaft was like a weaver's rod, and his iron point weighed 600 shekels. His shield bearer went ahead of him. Goliath stood and shouted to the ranks of Israel, "Why do you come out and line up for battle? Am I not a Philistine, and are you not the servant of Saul? Choose a man and have him come down to me. If he's able to fight and kill me, we will become your subjects." But if I overcome him and kill him, you will become our subjects and serve us. Then the Philistine said, this day, Goliath said, this day I defy the armies of Israel. Give me a man and let us fight each other. On hearing the Philistine's word, Saul and the Israelites were dismayed and terrified. I want to pull out some lessons for us when we face our giants. What do you do? Now, I'm going to keep this simple because we got to keep it simple, right? This has got to be a simple outline. The first thing that I want you to see is when we are faced with our giants and with our Goliath, the first thing is this: you've got to learn to evaluate your enemy. A lot of people often deal with the enemy, they don't even know who that they're battling against. And if you are going to evaluate that enemy, the first thing you need to do is check out his appearance. And you look at that in this story, the appearance of this man, because what happened is when you get this humongous guy, the attitude could be okay, it's great, or you can be fearful because the appearance of the enemy, when you evaluate it, it could be fearful. They gathered in the valley. Suddenly, this Philistine camp emerges, their champion, Goliath of Gath. The word champion, actually, in Hebrew is very interesting. This word champion means the man between. The idea is a mediator, the man between two armies, a representative, if you may. Here he came out to specifically represent those who are opposing the one and true God. This guy is over 9 feet tall. Wow. His bronze helmet and his armor of bronze weighs 125 pounds. Just the point of the spear that he carries weighed over 15 pounds. This is a formidable champion. Now he's opposing the people of God. And when Saul, the champion of God, and the scripture tells us he was not a 5'4" guy either. Like this guy, the Bible tells us that Saul was a pretty big guy, but not as big as Goliath. But when they saw the Philistines' words, they were dismayed. When they heard, they were dismayed and they were terrified. Oh, how soon they forgot what God said to Samuel as he walked to Jesse and his sons in the previous chapter. Look at that in 1 Samuel chapter 16, verse 7. But the Lord said to Samuel, do not consider his appearance or his height. Actually, he's referring to King Saul, for I have rejected him. The Lord does not look at the things people look at. People look at the outward appearance, but the Lord looks at the heart. May I add something there? That is a good way for us to look at people. Do not look at people from out of their appearance or judge people in terms of their appearance. But I was watching a little bit of the inaugural presidential celebration in the U.S. and some of the things that are coming out. Wow. And I'm just looking at this, and I'm saying to you that this is a good way to judge people. Don't judge people by their appearances. Judge them by their character. And the people, and that is what God is saying. He looks at people totally from a different perspective. Wow. And this giant in our lives are often fearful in its appearance. So you got to make sure when you evaluate, check out his appearance. Secondly, check out the way he talks. Because he can appear sometimes to be insulting in the words that he speaks. Here he was challenging the Israelites to a winner-take-all match. He was doing this day, and you know that the scriptures that in verse 16 actually tells us for 40 days the Philistine Goliath, came forward every morning and evening and took his stand. Can you imagine? Morning and evening hurling insults to God's people. Morning and evening for 40 days. This guy, have you ever been, you know, I play sports, and one thing I could not stand is people who are so cocky and full of themselves. You just look at the words that they say, the things that they say. You know, Goliath could have taken heed and maybe would benefit if he would have just maybe spent the time and maybe find a way to read 1 Samuel chapter 2, verse 3. In fact, even in Proverbs chapter 16, verse 8, what did the Bible say? Pride goes before the fall. God created us and gave us gifts and talents so that we can what? We can turn around and serve God with our gifts. Serve him with you and bring glory to him. In 1 Samuel chapter 2, verse 3, right after Hannah, yesterday we had the joy of dedicating one of our family's sons to the Lord, Jacob. But right after Hannah dedicated his boy Samuel to the Lord, listen to her prayer. Because if you are struggling with arrogance and pride, this will benefit you greatly. So take heed. And like I said, it probably benefited Goliath if he would have just taken the time. In 1 Samuel chapter 2, verse 3, here's what Hannah, this great godly woman, she said, "Do not keep talking so proudly, or let your mouth speak such arrogance. For the Lord is a God who knows, and by him deeds are weighed." Unfortunately for Goliath, he did not see it coming. So check out the way he talked. Thirdly, check out the way, check out his motive. When you evaluate your enemy, check out his appearance. Check out the way he talked. Check out his motive, because the enemy has one goal in mind: to discourage you and cause you to be fearful. That was what happened to the people of Israel, terrified, and they fled. Not a single man to be found that would go out and face Goliath. Not even their champion, King Saul, their commander in chief. And I want you to notice something, that the children of Israel were terrified even before a sword was drawn. The battle has not begun. They were already afraid. Frightened before one Philistine lay a hand on them. I think it is true that the battle is won before what? Before the battle has begun. And it's also true that the battle is lost before the battle has begun. What is your attitude this year? And sometimes we got lost and we got so terrified and fearful we become enslaved. But there is no question that Goliath is an impressive enemy. Let me just kind of leave this point with this one part. This is such a formidable force. This dude is a bad dude. This guy is big. You know, he is like an MMA fighter in his fight night. He's the main event. People hear the announcer goes, "It's time." You see him come out of his room, and he's got this big headphones over his head. What kind of music do you think this bad dude was playing? Do we have something like that? Maybe this is some other thing. Maybe this is what it was. He was just ready to rumble. He's a bad dude. Listen to this. Maybe the music that he was listening to.
I'm bad.
dude was bad. But as you evaluate the enemy, it is kind of overwhelming. You got the whole nation in fear. It seems like victory is completely impossible. You're going to face your giant this year. You better make sure you understand the enemy that you're dealing with. Identify him. Look at him. Here's my second point, which is the last point. Like I said, we got to keep it simple. Learn to fight the enemy God's way. Evaluate your enemy. Learn to fight the enemy God's way. Let me quickly read those, because I got to read that to keep the context. Now David was the son of an Ephrathite named Jesse, who was from Bethlehem in Judah. Jesse had 8 sons, and in Saul's time he was very old. Jesse's 3 oldest sons had followed Saul to the war, the firstborn Eliab, the second Abinadab, and the third Shammah. David was the youngest. The 3 oldest followed Saul, but David went back and forth from Saul to tend his father's sheep at Bethlehem. For 40 days, the Philistine came forward every morning and evening and took his stand. Jesse said to his son David, "Take this ephah of roasted grain and these 10 loaves of bread for your brothers and hurry to their camp. Take along these 10, I don't know why he, maybe it's a cheese sandwich that he was supposed to, because he takes some cheeses, right? 10 of them. See how your brothers are and bring back some assurance from them. Early on in the morning, David left the flock in the care of a shepherd, loaded up and set out. As Jesse had directed him, he reached the camp as the army was going out to its battle position, shouting the war cry. Verse 21, Israel and the Philistines were drawing up their lines facing each other. David left this thing with the keeper of supplies, his staff, ran to the battle lines and asked his brothers how they were. He was talking with them. I want you to mark that verse 23. Goliath, the Philistine champion from Gath, stepped out from his lines and shouted his usual defiance. And notice that last part. And David heard it. And whenever the Israelites saw the man, they all fled from him in great fear. Now the Israelite has been saying, "Do you see how this man keeps coming out? He comes out to defy Israel. The king will give great wealth to the man who kills him. He will also give him his daughter in marriage and will exempt him family." Boy, that's a pretty good benefit. Wow. You're going to get a lot of money. You get the king's daughter. You'll be exempted from tax. That's a pretty good deal. Maybe that's why in verse 26, David kind of heard it and looked back. See, what are you telling? Run that by me again? Yeah, it's money and women there, David. Go, just. And I'm going to show you, as we learn how to fight our Goliath, through this man, David, what did he do? This is what we know. Let me just outline what we know about David, because this is very important to face your Goliath and your giant in your life. The first thing that we know about David is that David was God's anointed man. There must have been something about David that God put his finger of approval upon this boy. God is anointed one. 1 Samuel chapter 16, verse 6. Surely the Lord's anointed is before me. That is the Lord's anointed. God must have found favor in this boy. Secondly, here was a boy with a heart after God. Chapter 16, verse 7. But the Lord said to Samuel, "Do not consider his appearance or his height, for I have rejected him," referring again to Saul. The Lord does not look at the things people look at. People look at the outward appearance, but the Lord looks at the what? At the heart. He knows the heart of this man, of David. In fact, God was contrasting this shepherd boy with the great king Saul. God is not impressed on how one looks. He doesn't care how tall you are. God is not impressed with the externals. He looks on the real you. He looks in your heart. He sees who you are in the private life. He must saw something in the heart of this man. So David was a man after God's own heart. And thirdly, he was the chosen servant of God. And you find in chapter 16, right out through verses 8 to 10, you will see this phrase is repeated over and over again, that this is the Lord's chosen. Plus, David was the youngest. He was a shepherd boy, and yet he was the Lord's servant. Number four, he was spirit-empowered. In verse 13 of 1 Samuel chapter 16, the Spirit of the Lord came how? Powerfully upon David. From that day on, the Spirit of the Lord anointed him as the Savior of the people of Israel. From that day on, David was a Spirit-led, Spirit-filled, Spirit-controlled man. These are all, I mentioned that to you, because these are all spiritual qualities you must have in order to deal with your Goliath. But the question is, how do you develop these qualities, Pastor? Let me draw again from the story. Here's the first thing. Be faithful with the little things. He chose a shepherd boy who was out in the field, just being faithful to what he was called to do. But little did David know that God was preparing him for the big things in life by teaching him to be faithful with the little things. That is a great lesson, ladies and gentlemen. That's a word for us this morning as we begin 2017. Don't you agree? Because God wants you to be faithful in those little things. But Pastor, this is just kind of, those are little things, but those you will not believe. As we read the story, and we're going to see it next week, how God has prepared David from the mountains of the sheep where he was looking after to a greater things that he has planned for him. Be faithful with the little things in church, wherever. He said, well, I'm teaching Sunday school. Are you guys having a great time at the service? Be faithful in some of those things. In your D group, whichever you've been called to do, use your gift. It may be in a little way, in a little insignificant that you may think. God wants you to be faithful, God's people, in the little things before he gives you the big things. Because why would God entrust to you a big responsibility if you are not being faithful with the little things? One day, David decided to send him to the battlefield, provide them with some cheese sandwiches, and to find out how they were doing and then report back to his dad. What happened? As a willing son, he obeyed and he went, just being obedient to the things that he'd been called to do. Menial things that you may think, but having no idea at all of the greater things that he will face. But God was preparing him. God was raising him up to be the champion of Israel who will defeat the giant Goliath and defend the honor of God. But it started off with being faithful. Can I encourage you, Mosaic, in whichever area that God has called you, be faithful in those little places. You might as well be in a place where God is preparing you for something big. Secondly, not only be faithful in the little things, see your Goliath as an opportunity to exercise your faith. And as David was talking to his brothers, look at how I draw that out of this, because I see the action of this man, David. As Goliath stepped out from his lines and shouted his usual defiance, which means talking down the God of Israel, King Saul and the rest of the army were terrified and they all fled. But David stood his ground. As he was talking with them, Goliath the Philistine champion from Gath, stepped out from his line. When he shouted his usual defiance, David heard it. But what did David hear? I believe that he saw this as an opportunity for him, as God has been preparing him right from the mountain, the hill countries of Palestine, looking after the sheep. The first thing that he heard, I believe, was that he heard the lies of Goliath. He recognized that they were lies. Because one of the most effective way of facing your giant is, folks, this, is to recognize that the evil one is telling lies. He was talking down on the God of Israel. But David knew who the God of Israel was. He knew that what Goliath was saying was a lie. That was no way that God was going to be taken down or his people was going to be taken down. So bring it on. He is not going to be defeated. Let me ask you then the question, how do you recognize the lie? How did David recognize the lie? By knowing the truth. By knowing the truth. Do you know why some of us get taken down by our giant? Because when they start yelling their lies at us, we don't know the truth well enough to see that it's a lie. David noticed that this was a lie. He has been around God long enough. He knew the promises of God's word enough that when he heard the lies, so Goliath said, "What?" He heard what he was doing. He said, he's lying. He can't defeat God. Why do you let him say that, King Saul, champion of the people of Israel? People who knows the truth of God's word hear the pressure and the taunting that comes from the enemy. And they keep on trusting God. Mosaic, get in the Word of God. Stay there. You're going to be successful in dealing with your giant? Don't wait till you come to Sunday to open your Bibles. Don't wait for your discipleship group to open your Bibles. Hear the Word of God. Like I said, every night, I put on the scripture. I go to bed with scriptures being read to me. I wake up in the morning, the scripture is being read to me. Saturate yourself with the word of God so that when that taunting and the hurling comes, you can tell that it's a lie. David saw that. David heard it. That's the first thing he heard. The second thing he heard is he heard the intimidation. He should have joined the rest and run, but he couldn't. God has been preparing him for this moment to be Israel's champion against the enemy and defend the honor of the Almighty. He saw this moment as an opportunity to live out his faith and trust the God who is greater than this intimidation. By the way, greater is he that is inside of you than he that is outside. He saw this moment. This was a battle worth fighting. And that's the other thing. When it comes to battling, I think you're going to see that in some of your outlines, and you're going to just pull this out a little bit more in your study in your D group. Sometimes you're going to have to pick your battles. And sometimes the battle is put there. And sometimes, you know, let me just, sometimes God is the one who put the battle in front of you. But he heard this intimidation. And when the people of faith is faced with intimidation and lies, you know what the people of God do? They see it as an opportunity to exercise their faith in the God who is greater than the champion of the enemy who is trying to intimidate them. Thirdly, what did he hear? Not only he heard the lie, he heard the intimidation, and lastly, he realized the significance of the moment. There was a lot at stake at the moment. He heard Goliath's word. Choose a man and have him come down to me. If he's able to fight and kill me, we will become your subject. But if I overcome him and kill him, you will become our subjects and serve us. This is significant because the future of the nation of Israel is at stake. The problem is, who is going to fight for the nation? And God raised David. He showed up. But I'm the one who believe. I don't think that he just happened to be there and God chose him to be the champion of Israel to defend the honor of God, God's word, and his glory. I believe this was all divine providence. It's not by accident that he was a shepherd boy looking after those sheep on the hillside. It was not by accident that he found himself in the king's palace playing the harp to cheer up the king. It was not by accident that Jesse sent him to the front line to bring food to his brothers and report back to his father. God was preparing him for such a time as this. Reality is not about David, we find in this story. Really, it is not about David. This is about the God of David. As we will find out next week, that the battle is the Lord's. And as we continue with this divine providence, and you're going to learn more, so what was the result when everything was put in place? Evaluate your enemy. Fight your battle the way God fights. See it differently. Keep your attention. Sometimes we come so discouraged in our walk with the Lord because we do not fight as we hear next week, because we fight the battle with our own human strength. Just a little bit teaser for next week. You know, Saul said, okay, if you're going to fight Goliath here, put on all of this. Put on my armor. And David said, no, put that to the side. Because I don't think that battle will be won by human means. The battle that we're going to win, that is a battle, is going to be in the name of Jehovah himself. That is his name. And that's the battle it's going to be. Let me conclude. There you have it. I want to ask you as we close, what is your enemy that you're facing right now? What is your Goliath you're facing? Because every one of us have something. It could be a financial problem. Maybe this last year you've lost your job. That's your Goliath. It could be a struggle with depression or some sickness. That's your Goliath you're dealing with. Maybe you have lost a dear one, and they left a vacuum in your life, and you feel the pressure from all directions. It could be an addictive sin that plagued you. It could be a problem in your marriage. It could be all kinds of things. It could be cancer. And you're facing that giant, whatever it may be for you, and you are going, oh my, this is huge. I don't know how in the world I'm going to be facing, how I'm going to get out of this mess. I don't know how I am going to ever defeat this one. I don't know what to do. And God's people, it's so easy then for us to get consumed with looking at the enemy and become intimidated. Because that's what the entire nation of Israel did. And I know this is a church, we are going to face our own Goliath. As we have done, probably faced right now, as I speak to you personally, you're facing your own personal Goliath. And it would be foolish not to believe that. But we're going to talk about it in terms of the victory that we have in God. David said in verse 7, 37, powerful words, he said these words, the Lord who rescued me, the Lord who rescued me from the paw of the lion and the paw of the bear, will rescue me from the hand of the Philistine. The Lord. We're going to talk about the victory. Because greater is he that is in you than he that is out in the world. And David believed that to fight this battle is not going to happen man's way. It must be fought God's way. And he understands as a man after God's own heart that God's ways are not our ways. And God loves to achieve victory not through strength, but through weakness. Paul says in 2 Corinthians chapter 12, but he said to me, my grace is sufficient for you. If you have lost a loved one, let me just kind of pray this over you, pronounce this over you. God's grace is enough for you. For my power is made perfect, God said, in your weakness. Therefore, I will boast all the more gladly about my weakness, so that Christ's power may rest on me. David understood that he was not fighting for God. He understood that God was fighting for him. May the Lord bless each one of you as you look at your own life and the giants that you face. Know your giant well. Know him. And understand that the battle is the Lord's. No human. Take your human effort down. You believe God is more powerful? To deal with your thing? This is how we're going to close. You feel like to go over, walk over to somebody, and maybe put your arm around somebody, or just put it around. We close that way because we're going to pray the 23rd Psalm. We're all going to pray it. Just walk over to somebody and just kind of, you know, support that next person and just go over that person. Let's all recite the 23rd Psalm and then we close. Beautiful Psalm. The Lord is my shepherd. I have all that I need. And all God's people say, God bless you.